Hello and welcome to Inside Magazine. On today's show, we examine the life of women in Orthodox Judaism. Well, in the context of traditional Jewish culture, the woman should be a model wife, an exemplary mother. But over the last century, some things have changed. Women in religious communities are bound by numerous laws that effectively take them out of the public sphere. However, in recent years, some Orthodox women have decided to challenge tradition without renouncing their religion. Well, many claim to be feminists, while others simply demand more rights and equality within the Orthodox world. What you'll learn about these women may be disturbing or shocking, but there are signs of a slow revolution taking place in the religious world. Well, here's Orthodox and Feminist, a story by Michael Blum and Florence Chevalier for I-24 News.
For 25 years, these women gather once a month in Jerusalem to pray at the Kotel, the Western Wall, the most sacred site for Judaism. A collective prayer is said on the first day of each month of the Hebrew calendar, traditionally a day of celebration for women. This morning, a few hundred of them have arrived from different parts of the Jewish community. The women of the Wall sing in public, pray out loud. Some wear tallit, or prayer shawls, and others wear kippah and tefillin, ritual objects traditionally reserved for men. These practices have sparked many controversies, and people sometimes yell insults and throw stones. The ultra-Orthodox community has done everything to prevent these women from praying. But last year, the law ruled in favor of the women of the Wall. They may now pray as they wish. This morning, prayer took place peacefully, but under close police supervision. Some ultra-Orthodox Jews still protest, but they're quickly pushed back by the authorities. Ella Kenner is a member of Women of the Wall. She's ultra-Orthodox and a feminist.
From my point of view, the collective women prayer is extremely important. It is really powerful. People sometimes don't understand how powerful this prayer can be. It opens heaven's gates. We live now in a complex world. There are different elements, and we're trying to combine between them. I am totally feminist and totally religious.
Ella grew up in a secular family. At the age of 18, she joined the Israeli army, like most young girls her age. Well, this is when she got closer to religion, but she didn't give up on the feminist ideas she grew up with.
Although it's been a very long time, it's still very moving. This feeling of being enveloped, being sealed, connected to God.
Today, this mother of six fights for a better place for women in religious practice. But the concept is far from being accepted in the religious world.
I can say that some prayers are harsh. Sometimes I left the Kotel crying, but I don't like the war and fight terminology. That's not our intention. We come to pray with love for God, and when you love God, there's no place for wars.
Ella is not the only one to shake up religious traditions. In this studio in Tel Aviv, Daniela teaches dance lessons. This young Jewish woman has turned her passion into a living. Daniela teaches both men and women, breaking a major taboo. Ultra-Orthodox Judaism forbids women from dancing in front of men and from performing on stage. Jewish woman is first of all a mother. She's the one who educates the children and takes care of the house, a wife that must remain discreet.
I didn't look for anyone's authorization. I give myself the authorization. I don't believe it contradicts anything. I believe we do what we do with a lot of faith, a lot of humility, very modestly, and with a real femininity. I never intended to do something revolutionary. Today I understand it is revolutionary, as I see people's reaction.
Daniela caused a sensation 2 years ago when she created the ballet company Nahara, or Light in Hebrew. Four dancers, all religious women, perform in front of a mixed audience. Feminine figures are almost invisible on Israeli religious stages, but Daniela wants to alter this reality and make it possible for young religious girls to have a presence in the dance scene. After being on stage in Israel, the company is preparing for its first European tour. Daniela approves every dance movement. Nonetheless, she's set a decent dress code for her students.
There's nothing provocative, nothing defiantly sensual or anything like that. There are beautiful women, excellent dancers. I'm not trying to hide anything about them. Regarding the clothing, we're trying to make our way through. On one side, it should not hide. On the other side, it should protect our body's dignity.
My name is Tippi Nir. I'm 30 years old. I started to dance at the age of 23, which is considered as quite late. Now that I'm dancing, I feel like my fate isn't affected, but I must keep vigilant. I took the decision to do something I haven't done before, performing in front of a mixed audience, for the sake of my art and to serve God. I felt that if I didn't do it, I would suffocate.
I wouldn't call it feminism. Things change through time. Some things are sacred and therefore shouldn't change. That's the way it is and always will be. Equality doesn't matter here. But it is true that women are not completely integrated.
If there's any woman who's trying to make mentalities evolve, it's her, Hana Kehat. She founded Kolech, Your Voice, 15 years ago. The first Israeli religious feminist association. Tonight, she takes part in a debate about feminism and religion. Hana defends women's rights in general. She fights to grant them a more active part in the religious world.
The woman wants the same. She was also created in the image of God. She also wants to get closer to the holiness. She also wants to accede to things that were prevented from. She doesn't have to, but if that's what she wants, she has the right.
But there are objections. Hana's declarations are shocking. Her revolutionary speech is criticized. The public can't reconcile feminism and ultra-orthodoxy.
I don't claim that women belong to the kitchen. I'm just asking for women to be women, to fulfill their divine obligations in accordance with the Jewish law. They're more than welcome to develop their capacities, as far as the law allows it, without deviating from their religious precepts.
I think this group, which defines itself as feminist, is extremely marginal in the religious society. They are insignificant. The majority of religious Zionist movements don't take them seriously. They make a lot of noise, but numerically speaking, they're irrelevant. They don't represent any threat.
Raised in an ultra-Orthodox family, Hana Kehat eventually left her original environment. Now she's the icon of religious feminism, and her speech is quite a challenge to the establishment.
For the sake of justice and equality, which are fundamental Jewish values, we must give up on custom. We must give up on maternal traditions that are not part of the Jewish law. Today, my grandmother's lifestyle is irrelevant. My grandmother didn't go either to the university, and she didn't work. Times have changed. It's an absolute necessity today for Judaism to adapt itself to these values, which, to me, are tikkun olam, repairing the world. They emancipate us from this immoral system. The patriarchal system is immoral.
This is my bed. Everyone has her own space. Everyone can customize it however she wants, with her pictures, her stuff.
Sarah Vanish represents a new generation of young religious girls. At age 17, she lives and studies in Jerusalem. In this institute for girls, which houses 200 students, they study the Bible and Judaism all day long, and the Talmud as well, scriptures that are traditionally not taught to women.
It may seem original because in the past years, in the past generations, women didn't study. But 200 years ago, women weren't allowed either to become physicians or lawyers. Now it seems obvious there are female doctors, female lawyers, businesswomen. Women don't stay at home anymore taking care of the children. Although we must admit that it's a really important role. But they can do different things. They can go out of their home. They can blossom intellectually speaking.
After 1 year of study, Sarah, together with all of her classmates, will join the army for 2 years. A surprising choice, since in Israel, religious girls are not required to serve. It's even forbidden by most rabbis, but this institute encourages its students to enroll. For the school's principal, it's a religious duty to take part in the country's defense, even for girls.
The army now allows girls to keep their religiosity and their purity. It gives the girls the opportunity to remain religious. Not only that, in my opinion, girls get even more religious in the army. It can be a loud revolution, and it can be a quiet revolution.
It's a revolution this institute is proud of. Every year, its program attracts more and more students from Israel, but also from abroad. Sarah, Hannah, Ella, or Daniela, all ultra-Orthodox women. They study the Talmud, dance in front of a mixed audience, enlist in the army, all without giving up their religious practice. Blamed for impairing Judaism, branded as liberal, they claim nonetheless to be pioneers. They patiently take part in a mentality change inside the ultra-Orthodox world. Although these women still represent the minority, in a few years, perhaps, they won't be an exception.
We're joined by Michael Blum in the studio. Michael, thanks for joining us here today. So we see in this video here, in the film, that they're not ultra-Orthodox women that you highlight here, but how representative are these women of the feminist movement within the religious community?
Right now, we're talking about a group in minority. It's a new phenomenon. Being both feminist and ultra-Orthodox is not something obvious. It's clear that in the ultra-Orthodox world, it doesn't exist at all. In an Orthodox environment that can be described as more modern, it's an increasingly significant movement. It's slowly becoming more and more important. We're not talking about 1,000 women. As we saw, there are small groups trying to make their change in their community.
Well, as a religious journalist yourself, did you find anything that you didn't expect in the course of this project?
It's true. I was sometimes surprised by some women, by some speeches, not necessarily feminist speeches, but speeches about equality, from women who actually want to study the Talmud on a full-time basis. Seeing 18-year-old girls spending all day studying Mara, Talmud, scriptures traditionally reserved to men, to see women who really want to serve God like men do, to lay tefillin, to find a place of their own at the center of the ultra-Orthodox Judaism.
Was it hard? I know it's not every day that a camera gets put in front of these women. Was it hard for you to get access to them for the story? How open were they?
Precisely. It was really open. They have obviously opened their gates for us. But we couldn't shoot the prayers on Shabbat, for example, because we can't bring a camera into a synagogue on Shabbat. But even on Shabbat, prayers are led by women in some synagogues. But besides that, everything was open. We could shoot very easily. Many women have talked to us. As we saw in the film, husbands are actually supporting their wives. We had no difficulty meeting these women or hearing them.
Well, another aspect making headlines, especially highlighting feminist movement within these communities, is military service for women. How big of an issue is that?
It's not necessarily feminist, but more and more religious girls want to take part in the effort to defend Israel, as men do. Not necessarily as combat soldiers. The girls we saw in the film that study at the Lindenbaum Institute enlist in intelligence units, educational units. They want to participate at the highest level, but still remain religious. Now the army offers this possibility to the girls. They can still practice and remain ultra-orthodox in the strictest manner. And in parallel, belong to the IDF military force. That's something new and important within the ultra-Orthodox community.
Well, again, thank you very much, Michael Blum.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining us here in Inside Magazine. We'll see you next week at the same time.